All right, welcome back. It's still The Breakfast on Plus TV Africa. And this time around, we'll be focusing on the politics in Libya, and precisely a court in southern Libya on Thursday reinstated Saif al-Islam Gaddafi, son of the slain dictator Muammar Gaddafi, as a candidate in next month's presidential election. That's according to various media reports in the dailies. And of course, we have joining us now, Paul Ejimeh. Many thanks for joining us on this particular discuss, Paul.
Thank you for having me.
All right, fine. I just read that the court has cleared Muammar Gaddafi's son to, you know, to run for next month's election. Looking at all the antecedents, looking at all that's been happening in Libya, you know, is it a case of the apple does not fall far from the tree?
So Libya is a deeply divided country today. If anything, some even may call it a failed state. UN is leading a process to try to patch it up. After Libya, after the long-term leader Muammar Gaddafi was killed in 2011, after ruling the country for some 40 years. So it's still, you have foreign militia groups.
All right, we'll try and reconnect with Paul Ejimeh there as we process in this discuss. Mercy, you know, Libya has actually been into one form of political turmoil or the other since Muammar Gaddafi's ouster, and now the son has been cleared to run, you know, for a presidency, and a lot of people are saying that he may not really be too different from his father.
Well, it's really quite unfortunate because, you know, the civil war, if you want to call it the first civil war, 2011. And of course, it escalated into having, you know, rebels and that spread around the entire country and all of the protests. But, you know, the major concern now is that's the big issue. Mm. Apart from the fact that we're hoping that if this election eventually happens about the 24th of December, if I'm not mistaken, would it actually heal the wounds? Would it actually, you know, restore peace and all of the troubles that Libya has actually experienced in the past now? And also another big concern now is the fact that you have Saif al-Islam, that's Gaddafi's second son, who also had a role, because if you follow, he still has a case with the international court, the international community, because he was also involved in, at the time where you had the protests and all of that, he played a major role in abusing protesters, and the human issue concern is also a big question. Now that the court has actually cleared him of all of that, the point is, we still talk about the issue of peace and justice. Mm-hmm. And, you know, would you really see him having a chance? Would that not also bring back memories of all the pains that the people had actually gone through, you know, in Libya? Mm-hmm. So but I really do not know if that's a very big, a good decision. And I don't know what chances he actually has. He stands chances of even, you know, contesting, if he will contest the election, if there are chances of him winning that election, following the role that he played during the process and the time under the revolution that actually happened. Mm. We do have, Paul back online, Paul Ejimeh. It's good to have you join us. We're sorry for all of that break in transmission.
Thank you for having me again.
Okay, so let's continue the conversation with the fact that, do you think that with the elections coming through in Libya, would it bring peace? Would it, you know, restore, you know, peace and heal the land of all of the troubles that Libya has actually gone through?
I think somebody would be naive to believe that that will heal anything or lead to progress, because elections by themselves cannot translate to peace or democracy. And like I was saying, Libya is a deeply divided country. There are still foreign militia groups, and then there are, you know, war is divided. The East and the West are divided. UN is trying to mediate to have this. They have a unity government of national unity that is not really living up to the billing. The UN mediator, you can't believe it, Halis, resigned, you know, has tendered his resignation. election, a month of the election. That tells you something. His predecessor also resigned on the job because of pressure. So I think it goes beyond holding elections. In fact, what should matter is what is the outcome, what will be the outcome of that, what happens after the election, not really the fact that the election can take place.
All right, Mr. Paul Ejime, you know, this younger Gaddafi, you know, was charged with two counts of crimes against humanity for alleged murder and persecution, but he never was extradited to, you know, face these charges. You know, do you think that the Libyans, you know, as they had supposed, would actually be so forgiving, knowing all that time has gone on in that particular country for decades?
The context is important here. Not only that he's wanted, Saif is wanted by the ICC, he has also actually been sentenced to death by a Libyan court in one part of Libya in 2015, in absentia. So, but you see, his father still commands a case of nostalgia. And if you look at the way that Gaddafi was killed, a lot of water is being poured there. What the international community is about is they're not even looking at the welfare or the interests of Libyans. Because the Libyan resources are being, oil, for instance, being exploited and not to the benefit of Libyans. You may say whatever you have, you can say about Gaddafi. But when he was there, there was a measure of peace. But now the country is divided. The country is virtually almost a failed state. So elections will not heal it. And the son is trying to ride on the crest of his father's popularity when he was alive. Whether or not that will get him the position is another thing. There are perhaps about 100 candidates that are running, and most of them have baggages. There is Khalifa, who is leading the so-called Libyan army. And then the only moderate person is the president of parliament, the speaker of parliament. So it is just a way of trying to create an impression that something is working. But I think the outcome will perhaps shock those who think that Libya is in a good state to conduct any credible election. There has to be peace building. There has to be trust building among Libyans. That has not happened. And then you want to foist a government on them. It's not going to last. Even if you got somebody elected, that is not going to bring the problem. Let them go to the get Libyans to because Libya is at war against itself. And then there has to be reconciliation. There has to be trust among the citizens before you can talk about credible or transparent election. I think this is just deja vu. They are trying to give the impression that it is working, but it's not working. NATO led a process that took out Gaddafi, no questions asked. In fact, Obama, who was the president of America then, said that was one of the decisions he regretted. Because they took out Libya without thinking about the aftermath, about post regime change without post regime strategy. And that has happened in so many places, in Iraq, also in Afghanistan, and Libya, and so on and so forth. So the international community has its job cut out for it.
Okay, so what does this mean, and what will this mean if Saif al-Islam Gaddafi contests for this election, and what are his chances of winning, knowing the fact that he played a major role during the protest where he attacked his protesters?
Yes, he was trying to protect his father, if you like. Gaddafi was, his father was in government, so I think he did what any son, any child can do. But the point is, have Libya healed to the point where they can forgive him? Gaddafi still control, still have the support that he used to have when he was alive? His chances will be tested by the election. I don't think he probably has, they'll probably end up with where none of the candidates winning at the you know, the first round, and then he gets into horse trading. And who knows? He's just one of the candidates. His chances are 50-50. And but he could also be part of the kingmakers if he manages to get himself to a position where he garners sufficient vote to be able to have an input into who now wins eventually.
All right, Mr. Ejime, but what does this really tell about the legality or otherwise of all of this? That, you know, you have indeed said that he had been sentenced by a court, you know, in Libya, you know, and then again, he coming out to contest. Don't you think the average policeman should be arresting him? What does this really tell? Doesn't it spell lawlessness on the part of the Libyan system?
And that is what we are talking about, that holding an election in a place that is so divided, in there's lawlessness, this West and the East. There is a general who says he's the field marshal, Khalifa. He is there, he is one of the candidates. He led, he was attacking the Tripoli government all along, and now he's thrown his heart into the. So he's one of them. And so it's not just Gaddafi's son. There are many who have heavy baggage that they are bringing to it, to this election. So it questions the legality, like you mentioned, the credibility of the process. And so, is it an election for the sake of an election? And from after that, what happens? Because that is the issue. You don't hold, what is the end game? What is the objective of those who are calling for this election? Is it to give a semblance of security, of stability, when in fact, in reality, on ground, there is nothing to show that Libya is in a position to run a state, like a stable state? Elections cannot bring that about. It is going down to address the issues that brought Libya to this to his knees from 10 years ago, from the killing of Gaddafi. Libyans are divided, and then you have foreign forces there, the militia groups of supporting one group or the other. And, you know, so you can't have a credible, transparent, or free and fair election under this kind of condition. I think those who are calling for election, I don't know what they have in mind, but that is not the solution to the Libyan crisis at the moment.
Okay, I like the fact that I know that in the course of this conversation, you have mentioned that the solution to the crisis and all of the issues going on in Libya is not having an election. Can you categorically tell us what then should be done? What should stakeholders in Libya do? And of course, we also know the role the United States actually played, you know, in the whole Libya crisis. Is there anything that is expected of them?
Okay, yes. You see what happened in Afghanistan. Going to impose or transplant democracy does not work. You leave people to elect, to decide their fate. That is what happens. It wasn't Libyans per se. A section of Libya were the ones that were against Gaddafi. And then NATO supported that group to take out Gaddafi. And now they cannot manage what the outcome. So that is the issue. Leave countries to be their own. It is a question because of oil resources. That is what is happening. Now there is no government, so anybody and everybody can go and exploit the resources, the oil resources of Libya. That is what is happening. If it was under a government, that will not happen. But they are looking for either a government that is amenable to their, what they say, or they create crisis to be able to exploit exploit that situation and begin to take the resources of the people. Let the Libyans be the one to determine their fate, their government, and the management of their resources. This external interference, because that is what it is, in the name of intervention trying to help Libya. You can't love Libyans more than themselves. Libyans to have their problem, no country can tell you that they don't have issues. But let them manage those crises, let them manage their differences, and be able to govern themselves. It is about self-determination. Let international community not come under the guise of trying to help people now, but when it actually they are furthering their own interests. Let the Libyans be the ones to govern Libya, and that Libya, and that is what should happen. This meddling has not helped and will never help. It didn't help in Iraq. It didn't help in Afghanistan. It's not going to help in Libya.
All right, thank you so much, Paul Ejime, International Affairs Analyst, for your input. Indeed, what the Libyans need right now is self-determination. They need to manage their resources and, of course, all that concerns them by themselves. We do appreciate your time.
Thank you for having me.
All right, well, we'll be taking a quick break. When we come back, we'll be focusing on football. Did Messi deserve the Ballon d'Or? In a moment, stay with us.